Right ascension and declination define a coordinate system that lets us describe where objects are in the sky. They're similar to the longitude and latitude system we use to define locations on the Earth. Right ascension is similar to longitude. It tells us how far east or west from a specific point in the sky the object is. Declination is like latitude. It tells us how far north or south the object is. In this question, we're going to use the right ascension and declination information for the stars in your constellation to help you figure out when the constellation is highest in the sky and how it appears to move in the sky from our location. The Earth's spin lets us define a celestial sphere, an imaginary sphere surrounding us. As we rotate, the stars appear to be fixed to this giant sphere as it slowly spins around us. There are certain special points on this sphere. One is the North Celestial Pole, which is an extension of the Earth's North Pole into space. Another is the South Celestial Pole, which is directly above the Earth's South Pole. A third important marker is the celestial equator. As you might guess, this line lies right over the Earth's equator. Declination is the way we define how far north and south of the celestial equator a star is. Declination can have values ranging from plus 90 degrees to minus 90 degrees. Plus 90 degrees means the star is directly over the Earth's north pole. In other words, the star is at the north celestial pole. At minus 90 degrees, the star is at the south celestial pole. A star at 0 degrees declination is right over the Earth's equator. So look at the declinations of the stars in your constellation. The first part of this question is simply asking you to describe what part of the celestial sphere the constellation is on. If the declinations are in the 70s or 80s, you can say that the star is near the North Celestial Pole. Similarly, if the declination is in the minus 70s or 80s, then it's near the South Celestial Pole. If some of the stars in the constellation have negative declinations, while others have positive values, then the constellation crosses the celestial equator. If the constellation doesn't fit any of these descriptions, then you should say if it's in the northern or southern half of the celestial sphere. When you answer this question, make sure you say what declination values you're using. You don't have to list every star's declination here. It's okay to say, the stars in my constellation have declinations between these two values. Also, you only need to look at the declination degrees, not the minutes. As the Earth spins, some stars rise and set in our sky. Others stay up all of the time. We call these stars circumpolar. Still others never appear in our sky. They remain hidden below our southern horizon. The set of stars that fits into each of these categories depends on where we are on the Earth. As we travel north or south on the Earth, in other words, as we change our latitude, the way stars appear to move in our sky changes. So to answer this question, we first have to know what our latitude is on the Earth. Here in Southern California, the latitude is 34 degrees north, so that's the value we need to use. The next number we need is called the horizon angle. This is simply 90 degrees minus the latitude. Since our latitude is 34 degrees north, the horizon angle is 90 minus 34, which gives us 56 degrees. Now we can compare the declinations of the stars to the horizon angles. If a star has a declination that is larger than the horizon angle, then it's circumpolar. In other words, it stays in our sky all the time, circling around the North Celestial Pole as the Earth spins. If the declination is less than minus the horizon angle, then the star never rises above the horizon. Since minus the horizon angle means minus 56 degrees here, any star with a declination between minus 56 and minus 90 degrees will stay out of sight. Finally, if a star has a declination between the horizon angle and its negative, that is, between 56 and minus 56 degrees, then we will see it rise and set. For many constellations, all the stars will be in the same category. If that's the case for yours, then you can give the range of declinations in your constellation and simply say that they all fit in the given category. On the other hand, if your constellation has some stars in one category and some in another, then you should say which stars are which type and give the declination values that tell you that. Let's look at an example of finding how a star moves in the sky. Imagine one of your stars has a declination of minus 18 degrees. Note that on the constellation table, it's the degrees part of the declination that is most important. The minutes are a fine adjustment on that angle. We've already seen that the horizon angle at our latitude is 90 minus 34 degrees, which equals 56 degrees. The star has a negative declination, so it's in the southern half of the celestial sphere. That tells us that it's not going to be circumpolar in our sky. However, it's not below minus 56 degrees, which means it does rise above our horizon. In fact, it's between minus 56 and plus 56 degrees, so it rises and sets from our location. While declination tells you how far north or south in the sky the star is, right ascension tells you how far east of a particular point the star is. Right ascension divides the sky up into 24 hours. Yes, this is a confusing way of naming things. Moving west to east. Each hour of the night, the Earth's spin causes the sky to shift by roughly 1 hour of right ascension overhead. The right ascension that's overhead at any given time of night, such as midnight, also changes gradually through the year as the Earth moves around the Sun. So in late September, if you look straight up at midnight, the stars you are looking at are at 0 hours right ascension. However, a couple of weeks later, in early October, 1 hour of right ascension will be overhead. A couple of weeks after that, in late October, 2 hours of right ascension will be overhead. You can keep this up over the entire year, advancing by 2 hours each month, until by early September of the following year, when you'll see stars at 23 hours right ascension overhead. By late September, you'll be back to 0 hours right ascension, which is the same thing as 24 hours. So in this part of the question, you should look at the right ascensions of the stars in your constellation and decide what time of year they'll be overhead at midnight. As with the declination question, it's okay to group the stars. If all of your stars have a similar right ascension, then you can say that they will all be highest at the same time of year. If you have a range of right ascensions, then you should say which ones will be overhead at midnight at which times of the year. Remember to list the data that supports this. Consider a star with a right ascension of 3 hours and 45 minutes. In this case, we should look at both the hours and the minutes. Just like with time, each hour of right ascension is divided into 60 minutes. So a star at 3 hours and 45 minutes is really closer to 4 hours than it is to 3. Remember that the starting point is late September, and we advance 2 hours of right ascension each month. That means that 4 hours of right ascension will be overhead at midnight 2 months after late September, or in late November. For this question, you should simply review a map of the constellations to see which ones are closest to yours. If the map you're looking at has the actual boundaries of the constellations, you should list all of the ones that share a boundary with yours. If the map just lists the patterns of stars, you should include the constellations that surround yours. Remember, if your constellation is near the eastern or western edge of the map, that you should include constellations on the opposite edge.